happy 4th of July for all of us who celebrate the independence of our country. It is not freedom when everything is permitted. This is slavery. Think about that. It is not freedom when everything is permitted, but this is slavery. These were the words from Saint Paisius, one of the newest canonized saints of our church, this monk who lived on Mount Athos for many years. And he said these words, "It is not freedom when everything is permitted, but this is slavery." This weekend in America, we're all thinking about freedom, of the independence of our country. And hopefully we're thanking God for the freedom that we have. My family and I, this past week, were up in New Hampshire for a few days. And when I was in New Hampshire, everywhere, I saw the license plates in New Hampshire. Live free or die. Live free or die. Of course, that comes from the words of the famous American patriot, Patrick Henry, who said, "Give me freedom or give me death." Freedom is one of the greatest blessings we have. It's something that all of us long for. We've seen in the world over the past few years, the Arab Spring, where you saw people rising up, trying to demand their freedom. And we see people who are oppressed, always looking for the day that they can be truly free. Now we in our country have to reflect on our history and thank God for the freedom that we have. Over 200 years ago, when the patriots of our country demanded freedom from Britain, and they fought for that freedom, and that gave us the great country that we have, a country where we have abundant freedom. And yet, what do we do with our freedom? This is something to think about. And also, from where does our freedom come? We have to thank the American patriots 100 years ago. But the first person who gave us freedom was our Creator, God Himself. When God created the world and He created humanity, Adam and Eve, what's the first thing that God gave to the first humanity, the first people? He showed them His love. He created them out of His love. And then, of course, true love implies freedom. And so He gave Adam and Eve freedom, the freedom to choose. He said, "I love you. I'm creating you out of my love. But I love you so much, I'm going to give you freedom. I'm going to respect your freedom. You're free to love me back or not. You're free to choose to live in the Garden of Eden forever, or you can choose to eat from the fruit of the forbidden tree and then choose the path of death. You're free. God has given us that freedom." Think about it. Think about what an incredible gift that is. God gives each one of us the freedom to accept His love or to reject His love. He teaches us to love one another, and yet He gives us the freedom to truly love the other, or we can choose to reject the other, to even hate the other. This is the great gift, the greatest gift that God has given us, freedom. So how do we use that? God has also given us freedom, not only in our nature, the nature that He's given us, but He's given us freedom by the greatest events of history, through His death and resurrection. He said, "I know that evil is in the world because people have chosen the wrong path." And so there's much suffering and evil in the world and death in the world. But I'm going to free you from sin and death. And that's why Christ came. Christ came to live the perfect life, to show us the path that true freedom leads to. He gave us the freedom to choose over sin, over the power of Satan. And He even gave us freedom to choose the path of life over death. Death is not the end. So God has given us great freedom. But what do we do with our freedom? St. Paisius says, remember, it is not freedom when everything is forbidden. This becomes slavery. We become slaves to passions, to our desires, to our egocentric will. That's not freedom. That's slavery. One of the great prophets of the last century, Alexander Solzhenitsyn, the great Russian dissident and writer, who was a prophet in his own country of the Soviet Union and got kicked out of the Soviet Union, and then came to America and was a prophet here in America, and yet was rejected by many people because of his prophetic voice, and then went back to Russia after the fall of communism and continued to speak the truth, and in many ways was rejected there. This great voice had something fascinating to say about freedom. Back in 1976, in his Harvard address, he gave an address on the final, on the graduation day at Harvard, which was called A World Apart. And this is what he says. Listen to these words, these prophetic words, said 50 years ago about our country and about the West and about freedom and the misuse of freedom in the West. Solzhenitsyn said this: at the birth of American democracy, all individual human rights were granted because man is created in God's image. That is, freedom was given to the individual conditionally in the assumption of his constant religious responsibility. 200 or even 50 years ago, it would have seemed quite impossible in America that an individual could be granted boundless freedom simply for the satisfaction of his instincts or whims. Let me repeat that again, because that's a powerful statement. He said 250 years ago, even in America, it would have seemed quite impossible that an individual would be granted boundless freedom simply for the satisfaction of his desires and wishes. Subsequently, he goes on to say, all such limitations were discarded everywhere in the West. A total liberation occurred from the moral heritage of Christian centuries with their great reserves of mercy and sacrifice. State systems were becoming increasingly and totally materialistic. The West ended up truly enforcing human rights, even excessively. But man's sense of responsibility to God and society grew dimmer and dimmer. Solzhenitsyn points out a central element of freedom. With freedom comes responsibility. With great freedom comes great responsibility. I remember a dear friend of mine, Metropolitan John of Portugal. He would say, in America, you have one statue, the Statue of Liberty in New York, the statue that represents freedom. Come to me, all who labor and are heavy laden. Come to me, and I will accept everyone and offer them freedom. But Metropolitan John said, America should have one more statue on the other side of the country, maybe in San Francisco, saying the statue of responsibility. A statue of freedom needs a statue of responsibility. This is what is important for us to remember when we think of freedom. God said, you're free to do whatever you want. But if we want to truly experience life and to get the most out of life, we are called to use our freedom in a responsible manner. St. Paul says, you have been called to freedom, only don't use your freedom as an opportunity for the flesh, for your fleshly desires, but use your freedom to love one another. So we have a choice to make. We are free, and yet, how will we use our freedom? God says, you are free to love me, and yet you're also free to reject me. And we see plenty of people in our society rejecting God, even rejecting the idea of God. God says, I teach you to love one another, even your enemies. And yet we are free to not love one another, and to hate, and to reject the other. Christ says, you are free. I'm offering you an opportunity. Enter into my heavenly kingdom. Live under the reign of God, where you will experience peace and joy and love. And yet you are free if you choose not to live under the reign of God, but to live under the dark abyss of our egocentric desires. How will we use freedom? And what choices will we make? And how responsible will we be? Alexander Solzhenitsyn went on to say in his talk, destructive and irresponsible freedom has been granted boundless space. Society appears to have little defense against the abyss of human decadence, such as misuse of freedom for moral violence, especially against our young people. A couple years ago, the Supreme Court made a ruling in a case in California where there was a case brought up trying to limit the violent videos that our children can watch. And the Supreme Court said, our children have freedom. They have their rights. And they have the right to look at any video they want, no matter how violent. Think about that. We did that in the name of freedom. The most recent Supreme Court decision on same-sex marriage could possibly be another step in excessive freedom. Because where is it going to stop? People who say, my desire is this. I want this. This is the way I express my love. Do we have any limits? Or does freedom mean we can do whatever we want, as long as it satisfies my desire? Freedom and responsibility. And as followers of Jesus Christ, that responsibility means, how am I called a path, the narrow path that controls our egocentric desires, that limits our passions, and says, walk this narrow path. We are free to choose. Let us be careful in making a wise decision. Let us choose the path of responsibility, the path that follows the teachings of our Lord Jesus Christ. Freedom that allows all things is not freedom. That ends up becoming slavery.